In the last video, we introduced molarity as a way to measure concentration of a solution, but turns out that molarity actually is not the best way to talk about concentration in human physiology. We'll see why in a second. But for now, let's introduce a new but very, very related way to measure concentration. And that way is osmolarity. Osmolarity is very similar to molarity. You can actually see the word molarity in osmolarity, but there's a very important difference. So let's see what that difference is. To show you guys, I'm just gonna draw a big tank, fill it with some water, and add some solute particles to this solution. And to be specific, I'm gonna add 1 mole's worth of sodium chloride. But something happens with a molecule like sodium chloride. It's an ionic compound, and when placed in water, it actually dissociates or breaks up into the individual ions. So for every 1 molecule of sodium chloride, when I put it into water, it'll actually dissociate into its 2 ions, positively charged sodium and negatively charged chloride. And that will happen for every single one of these molecules. So if I start off with 1 mole of sodium chloride, I'll end up with 1 mole of sodium and 1 mole of chloride. That means that we end up with twice as many particles compared to what we started with. So whenever you factor in if the particles break up in solution in this way, we're actually not going to use the term moles anymore to describe how much of this particle we have. We're going to talk about them in terms of osmoles. So now we're going to use osmoles to help us calculate a new type of concentration known as osmolarity. So we start off with 1 mole of sodium chloride in this case, but we're going to end up with 2 osmoles worth of particles. And osmolarity is very similar to molarity, but we're going to use, instead of moles, the number of osmoles, which again is just the number of particles after the molecule has broken up or dissociated in solution, divided by the volume of the solution in liters. And whenever you calculate osmolarity, you can just write that unit as OSM, as opposed to the capital M that we saw for molarity in the last video. All right, so to really highlight the difference between osmolarity and molarity, what I wanna do now is just compare them and calculate molarity and osmolarity for a variety of different solutions. So now let's compare molarity versus osmolarity. To set up this comparison, I'm going to draw 3 different solutions. So I'm going to take this tank, fill it up with some water, and create 3 different solutions using this barrier shown here in red. In each compartment, I put 1 liter worth of water. So that's the volume of our solution. And in this solution, I'm gonna put 1 mole's worth of sodium chloride. In this second solution, I'm gonna put 1 mole's worth of glucose. So same amount, but just different type of solute. And in this third solution, I'm gonna put 1 mole of magnesium chloride, or MgCl2. So what we're gonna do first is calculate the molarity of each of these solutions. For every single one of these cases, we have 1 mole in 1 liter, and that means that the molarity in each case will just be 1. But now let's try calculating the osmolarity. And remember, to calculate osmolarity, we have to keep in mind whether these solute particles will break up or not in solution. So sodium chloride, as we saw, breaks up into 2 particles. So we'll end up with two osmoles as opposed to one mole. Two osmoles in 1 liter, so the osmolarity will end up being twice as much. So this particle breaks up. We'll have two osmoles in 1 liter, leading to an osmolarity of 2. Now let's try looking at glucose. Glucose is not an ionic compound. It will not break up into different ions in solution. So that means that if we started with 1 mole, we'll end up with 1 osmole, and the osmolarity will just be the same as the molarity. Now if we go to magnesium chloride, it is an ionic compound, and when put into solution, it will actually break up into 3 different ions, magnesium and 2 chloride ions. That means that if we start off with 1 mole of magnesium chloride, we'll actually end up with 3 osmoles worth of stuff. 3 times as many particles in the solution as what we started with. So 3 osmoles in 1 liter leads to an osmolarity of 3. So you can see that the osmolarity can be very different from the molarity based on whether or not the particle breaks up in water. But your body is made up of water. All your ions, all your solutes are swimming in a watery or aqueous solution. So that means when we're talking about human physiology and concentration, we always have to factor in whether or not the particle will break up or not. So from now on, we'll only and always use osmolarity to determine particle concentration when talking about human physiology. So osmolarity will be the concentration we'll use from now on. And since we will often need to compare the osmolarities of different solutions, so for example, which one's higher, which one's lower, I wanted to introduce the terms that we're going to use to compare the osmolarities of different solutions. So I'm going to draw this same compartment that we just worked with. And what we're going to do is use it to compare the osmolarities of different solutions. So for example, let's compare this second solution to this first one. Right off the bat, if you just look at the numbers, you can see that the second solution has a lower osmolarity compared to the first. 1 is less than 2. So we're just gonna introduce a term, a silly, stupid scientific term that's used to specify that that osmolarity is lower. So what we would say is that this solution is hypoosmotic compared to the first one. Hypo just means lower, and osmotic refers to the fact that we're talking about the osmolarity. So this second solution has a lower osmolarity compared to the first. What we could also say though is that this solution is hyperosmotic compared to the second solution. Hyper means more, greater, higher, and osmotic refers to the osmolarity. So it has a higher osmolarity than the second solution, so it is hyperosmotic. Just to practice more, let's compare this first solution to the third one. We can see that the first solution has an osmolarity of 2 compared to the third solution, which has an osmolarity of 3. So we'd say that this first solution is hypoosmotic compared to the third. And similarly, we could say that this third solution is hyperosmotic compared to the first. So hyper just means more, hypo means less. And anytime you see osmotic, you know that you're talking about the osmolarities. So these terms, hypoosmotic, hyperosmotic, or isosmotic, which means that the osmolarities are the same, can be used to compare the osmolarity of any solution to the osmolarity of any other solution. Okay, so who cares? That was Lame. Why is this important? Turns out that these osmolarities, these concentrations, hyperosmotic, hyposmotic, blah, 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 all that stuff actually super, super matters. So what we're going to do now is take all these bio concepts we just covered and combine them into one very important clinical application known as tonicity. And all tonicity means is, what effect does a solution have on a cell? So let's see what that means. So as a reminder, water always moves towards regions of a higher concentration of solute. We saw that was basically the definition of osmosis. What we also saw is that concentration is defined by osmolarity. So what we could also say is that water always moves towards a higher osmolarity. So now let's see how changes in osmolarity might affect your cell's health. So let's say I have a red blood cell, which I'm going to draw right here. And it has some solutes inside. These are usually things like potassium, proteins, and other ions. And the normal osmolarity inside the cell is 0.3. This osmolarity of 0.3 is pretty standard, and the normal osmolarity of your cells and also your internal environment. So you'll see this 0.3 number come up a lot in future videos. All right, so let's take this normal red blood cell with an osmolarity of 0.3 and put it into some solution that has some solute that I'm going to draw here in purple. And let's say that the osmolarity of this solution is also 0.3. So based on this picture, which way do you think water would go? So we said that water always goes towards regions of a higher osmolarity, but because the osmolarities are the same here, some water might end up leaving the cell. But at the same rate, water will enter because the osmolarities are exactly the same. So overall, in this case, water will neither enter or leave the cell. In a previous video, we called this state osmotic equilibrium. The concentrations or osmolarities on the inside and the outside are exactly the same. So water will not move in or out overall. Whenever this happens, when the cell neither gains or loses water from the solution, we say that the solution on the outside of the cell is isotonic. And this is usually what we want. We want our cells to live in an environment where they are perfectly happy, where they don't gain water, they don't lose water, they're just perfectly normal doing their thing. But what if we were to take this same cell and put it into a solution environment that is hypoosmotic, so it has a lower osmolarity? I'm going to take this exact same cell, has an osmolarity of 0.3, and put it into a solution that has a lower osmolarity. Let's make that osmolarity 0.2. Now we can see that the cell is not in osmotic equilibrium with its environment. The osmolarity on the inside is higher than the osmolarity on the outside. And we know that water always moves towards regions of a higher osmolarity. So in this case, water will move into the cell, making the cell swell up and potentially burst. Whenever this happens, whenever the cell gains water from the outside solution, We say that the solution on the outside of the cell is hypotonic. And one way to remember what hypotonic means is to think that in this case, the cell is swelling up with water. It's getting bigger, just like a hippo. So it's hypotonic or hypotonic. Anytime the cell swells up like a hippo, it's hypotonic or hypotonic. Let's look at a final case where the cell is placed into a super concentrated or hyperosmotic solution. If I take a cell whose osmolarity again is 0.3 and put it into a hyperosmotic solution. So osmolarity 0.3 on the inside, but on the outside, I have a highly concentrated solution, very concentrated with solute, and let's say that that osmolarity is 0.4. What will happen to this cell? Since water always goes towards a higher osmolarity, in this case, water will leave the cell, and you can actually see that the cell has shrunken and appears shriveled as a result. Whenever this happens, when the cell loses water to the outside solution, we say that the solution on the outside of the cell is hypertonic. So this is tonicity. All tonicity means is what effect will the outside solution have on the cell. If the solution has no effect on the cell, the solution is isotonic. If the solution causes the cell to gain water, the solution is hypotonic or hypotonic. If the solution pulls water from the cell, causing it to shrivel up, the solution is hypertonic. We'll use these facts in later videos to understand some very important clinical applications. For example, how different intravenous fluids and solutions affect your cell's health. But for now, one final thing is one thing to keep in mind is that tonicity, so isotonic, hypotonic, hypertonic, only refer to the solution on the outside of the cell. Also known as the extracellular fluid or ECF. So we always say that the solution on the outside of the cell is isotonic, hypotonic, or hypertonic. We never say that the cell or the solution on the inside of the cell has a certain tonicity.